Quote, "Of course the people don't want war. But after all, it's the leaders of the country who determine the policy. And it's always a simple matter to drag the people along, whether it's a democracy, a fascist dictatorship, or a parliament, or a communist dictatorship. Voice or no voice, the people can always be brought to the bidding of the leaders. That is easy. All you have to do is tell them they are being attacked and denounce the pacifists for lack of patriotism and exposing the country to greater danger." End quote. That was said by Hermann Göring at the Nuremberg trials. The aggressive manipulation of all available media is widely believed to have been integral to the acceptance of the false belief that social, political, and ethnic minorities were to blame for the problems which caused the immense suffering of the German people during the Great Depression, when the nation's currency became virtually worthless and unemployment topped 6 million. Testimony at the Nuremberg trials revealed that only weeks after gaining power with a small majority, the Nazis burned down the Reichstag on February 27, 1933, blaming it on communist terrorists in a false flag terrorist operation which was used as a justification to impose National Socialist dictatorship upon the German people to protect them from such attacks. A mentally disturbed, unemployed Dutchman, Marius van der Lubbe, who was beheaded for the crime following the obligatory Nazi show trial, was officially pardoned by the German government in January 2008. All of the available evidence suggests that the undeniably charismatic and eloquent Hitler then dragged Germany out of the Depression by its jackboot straps, with forced employment in the burgeoning arms, steel and coal industries, as well as the constantly swelling armed forces, agricultural labour camps and civil bureaucracy. By 1939, official unemployment statistics stated that there were only 300,000 people out of work, although that figure excluded women and Jews, the latter being omitted after they were stripped of their rights to citizenship in 1935. What is less well known is the fact that under Hitler, Germany transformed itself from a bankrupt nation into an economic powerhouse by issuing its own interest-free currency, backed by the sweat equity of the people, which many researchers consider the most likely reason why the House of Rothschild amassed the might of its European, Commonwealth and North American forces against Hitler's Third Reich. Quote, "We were not foolish enough to try to make a currency backed by gold, of which we had none. But for every mark that was issued, we required the equivalent of a mark's worth of work done or goods produced. We laughed at the time our national financiers held the view that the value of a currency is regulated by the gold and securities lying in the vaults of a state bank." End quote. That was said by Adolf Hitler, as quoted in Hitler's Monetary System, published at Renz.com. Pride, prosperity and nationalism were swallowing German society whole by the 1936 Berlin Olympics, when African-American Jesse Owens either delighted or embarrassed the Führer, depending upon which historical account you subscribe to, by winning 4 gold medals. Only 3 years before the invasion of Poland, Nazi Berlin was considered by the social elite to be the most fashionable city in post-depression pre-war Europe. This can very easily be explained, since it is well documented that Hitler did not want war with any nation except communist Russia, which he saw as the creation of a superstate for international Jewry, in the same way that Rakovsky did. War was, in actual fact, imposed upon Hitler by the houses of Rothschild and Windsor, via very well established and seemingly unaccountable means. Canadian researcher and self-confessed former Zionist Henry Macau wrote on his own website, quote, "Hitler didn't want a world war and had no stomach for fighting England, according to Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Lewis Kilsner, author of Churchill's Deception, Simon & Schuster, 1994. Hitler believed the future of Western civilization depended on the cooperation of Germany and her Aryan cousins, England and the United States. His territorial demands were limited to conquering communist Russia, which he regarded as a proxy for Jewish world ambitions. He was determined to avoid fighting a war on two fronts. The miracle at Denmark was in fact an extraordinary peace venture to England. In May 1940, the British were on the verge of defeat. The English army was trapped at Dunkirk. Rather than take them prisoner, Hitler halted his generals for 3 days, allowing 330,000 men to escape. Quote, "The blood of every single Englishman is too valuable to shed," end quote, Hitler said. Quote, "Our two people belong together racially and traditionally. That is and always has been my aim, even if our generals can't grasp it." End quote. Macau continued, "This is not an attempt to exonerate Hitler. His ideology of Aryan racial supremacy and his treatment of inferior races are abhorrent to me. My own grandparents were murdered by the Nazis. Nonetheless, we should understand that our view of Hitler is influenced by propaganda. The Allies were also guilty of atrocities and war crimes. Furthermore, Hitler was created, manipulated, and destroyed by the same Illuminist clique that runs the world today. End quote. Founding member of the Bilderberg Group, Prince Bernard of the Netherlands, was both a permanent resident of Berlin and a card-carrying member of the Nazi Party. According to George C. Hatton, in Rape of the Constitution, Death and Freedom, the prince was an officer in the Reiter SS Corps in the early 1930s, as well as a board member of the IG Farben subsidiary, Farben Bilder. Hitler's rise to power was allegedly financed by international bankers and industrialists, most infamously by German steel magnate Fritz Thyssen, who laundered vast amounts of Nazi capital through American banks Brown Brothers Harriman and United Banking Corporation of New York, with the alleged cooperation of a Dutch intelligence unit commanded by Prince Bernard. The allegations against Coca-Cola, which created Fanta Orange for the Nazis, IBM, which provided its punch card computer system for the concentration camps, as well as BBH and UBC, both of which served as offshore vaults for Nazi funds, holdings and assets, are well documented, yet rarely even mentioned in the mainstream media. It is also believed that UBC was in reality owned by the Thyssen family. The point is all the more revealing and sinister because George W. Bush's grandfather, Prescott Bush, worked for BBH and was a board member and shareholder of UBC. Along with Avril Harriman, Bush provided the Wall Street front for the Nazi war machine by claiming ownership of assets that in reality belonged to Thyssen. Bush, the Rockefellers and the DuPont family were also at the center of a nefarious plot to impose fascist dictatorship upon America in 1933, the year Hitler imposed Nazi control over Germany. Both political movements were financed by the same international banking interests controlled by the House of Rothschild. The plot was apparently foiled because its corporate conspirators enlisted the services of the highly decorated Major General Smedley Butler to lead the military coup and then oversee the declaration of martial law. Instead, during testimony he gave to a congressional committee in 1934, Butler publicly exposed the plans of the internationalists who wanted to replace the elected Rothschild stooge President Franklin D. Roosevelt with Nazi-style fascist dictatorship controlled by the multinational corporations, at least on the surface. If Butler really did prevent this from happening, then the coup was successful at a later date under the cover of a media blackout. The alleged conspirators were the American Liberty League, financed by the DuPonts, U.S. Steel, General Motors and Rockefeller Standard Oil interests, including Chase National Bank. To date, no charges have been brought against any of the individuals or corporations involved, whose power and wealth have continued to grow exponentially, suggesting that Butler's exposé was carefully planned to give the false impression that the land of the free had been saved from fascism, when in fact, it was already lost to the robber barons.